Hi, this is Mike Kendra from Civil War Talk. I'm here with Gary Casteel, and we're here to talk about the Longstreet Memorial. My first question for Gary was, what inspired him to be an artist?
When I was in the fourth grade in grade school back in West Virginia, I walked up to the teacher's desk, and on his desk was a art book that was laying open and had a photograph on the page of Michelangelo's David. I pointed at it and told the teacher at that day, that's what I want to do. He said, you want to be a sculptor. I had no idea what that was.
Next, I asked Gary, who came up with the idea for a Longstreet Memorial and how did you get involved?
Back in the early 90s, a group of Sons of Confederate Veterans out of Sanford, North Carolina, actually contacted me and a couple of other sculptors as well to look at the project and come up with some conceptual plans, ideas. I went down to Sanford, North Carolina, and was the only one, the only sculptor to do that. Met with them, the group there, and became instant friends, and to this day we're very close. And they offered me the commission that night.
I asked Gary how the location of the monument was chosen.
There were three locations originally intended, this being one. There was another that was further down Confederate Avenue on the curve right across from where the Confederate Soldier Memorial is located, and then one over next to where the little picnic park is. That was the one next to the picnic park behind the restroom area was scrapped immediately. The area that was across from the Confederate Memorial was actually chosen by Longstreet's wife, Helen Longstreet, in 1932 to place the original Longstreet Monument, which was never constructed. And so this left Pitcher's Woods as the remaining selection. We went for it. I love it. Everyone was very pleased with it. And so here we are today.
I asked Gary how he came up with the design for this memorial.
Well, we do know this about General Longstreet. One, he was a West Point graduate, well military trained, did not care for military equipage, never wore a sword, did not like all the fancy gold braid, all that sort of thing, pistols, it just wasn't there. He looked more like a farm boy on horseback. Here at Gettysburg. It was a hot day, no coat on. We know that. Letters are written that way. And so what we see today is vastly different. Why is that? Very simple. I came in with a few concepts of what we knew was correct. We were directed by the Park Service to make General Longstreet similar to the Yankee generals here at Gettysburg. As a line officer, as a commanding officer, full uniform, full dress, saddle skirt with all the gold braid, which he did not have, the whole nine yards. That's what you see because of that director.
I wanted to know if any of the other equestrian monuments at Gettysburg had influenced his design.
No, not one bit. In fact, I wanted to make it different than what was here at Gettysburg already. Ord, General Ord, he's on a horse with all four hooves down. Then you've got others around the park here with hooves up, down, in motion, standing, whatever. I wanted to try to do something that was different because Longstreet himself was different. Different in his military approach and in his life approach. So that was the uptake.
I asked Gary if there were any difficulties in creating and transporting this memorial.
The piece was actually sculpted at Gettysburg College in a warehouse. Now, the door in and out of the warehouse would not accept the height of the figure itself. And so we had to design the armature that we packed the clay onto so that we could take it in part in two pieces. So we went ahead and sculpted the piece. In fact, it had a ton of clay on the armature. Before we moved it to the foundry in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, we had to put a hoist in the ceiling, chain hoist one half the top off of the base, put it over on a pallet, load it up on the truck, come back, get the bottom half loaded on the truck, and down Route 30 we go to Lancaster to the foundry to start making the molds. And of course, when we get there, we put it all back together, repair all that, and then start the mold process to go into the casting.
I asked Gary if any of Longstreet's descendants had contacted him about this memorial.
Absolutely. They were involved from day one. Jamie Longstreet, who was the general's granddaughter, worked with us through the entire process. His great-grandson was with us. They approved the piece that I sculpted in clay, in fact, in the studio. And they're very close, yes.
I asked Gary to show us some of the details on the Longstreet Monument.
First of all, on James Longstreet's uniform, the buttons that you see there, those are actually reproductions of West Point buttons of the period when James Longstreet graduated from West Point. Why? Because a lot of officers of the Confederacy were West Point graduates. They were proud of that. And so they would actually have their West Point buttons on their Confederate uniforms, which were Union buttons. So be it. They were proud of that fact. All right. Now we also see all this, I call it paraphernalia, the pistols, the sword, the fancy saddle skirt with the gold braid, the portmanteau, the sash, the uniform with all the gold braid. Not so. James Longstreet didn't care for those things. He cared about one thing, dedication to duty and doing his job. He rarely, if ever, used those items. And so what we see here are those items that were required to get this monument on the battlefield. We were required to keep it at about 10% over life size. And so I found a horse locally, her name is Summer, lived on the Mummelsburg Road. She was half quarter horse and half Belgian. This is why the large hooves, the war horse effect, not the Arabians that you see George Meade setting on over on Cemetery Ridge. And of course, the Arabians weren't here at that time. And so what you see is a war horse that has strength and power to support a large man. James Longstreet was a large man. The horse is being held back by Longstreet as he's moving east to view his lines. So what happens, the horse, we call him Hero because that was Longstreet's favorite horse. Hero is actually scooching down and planting his hooves in the ground so that rear is pushing down. When that happens, that produces an artistic sculptural effect that gives an illusion of small horse. Not so. This is a big horse. James Longstreet was a big man. Now, I would like to point out one item that is rather interesting. Again, I go back to the original commissioning unit of the Longstreet Monument, and that was the Sons of Confederate Veterans from North Carolina. If you will come around this way, right here on the breastplate of the breast strap, you'll see these three leaves. Now, there could have been anything put there. There could have been CSA put there. There could have been an eagle put there. There could have been James Longstreet's initials put there. Me and the boys from North Carolina chose tobacco leaves because that is representative of North Carolina. We'll also go into the pedestal. There's been a lot of discussion on the pedestal. Where is it? Did the Sons run out of money? Is it going to be installed in 10 years? No, that's all hogwash. There was never a pedestal to be installed on this monument. It was always to be located on the ground. I wanted it on the ground, the Park Service wanted it on the ground. Why is that? Well, very simple. You've heard the term many, many times, to be placed on a pedestal makes you something special. That's an old line thought that came from Europe, brought to the United States. I think differently. I think of sculpture as being something you walk up to, you can touch, you can lay your hand on it, you can wrap your arms around it, you can love it, you can become part of it. Longstreet was an individual you could do that with. He was a common man. He was not what he considered to be the hierarchy of the South. He was a man, once again, who did his job. And so by placing him on the ground, you can come up here and you can walk around this piece and you can take your hand and put on his sword and stand here and say, "Here's my picture, Mom. I want to see it in 20 years from now." That's James Longstreet, and that's why he's on the ground. And the Park Service love it. I love it. And I've been told by the Park Service it is the second most photographed monument on the park. Don't know if that's true, but if it is, God love it.
I'd like to invite you to CivilWarTalk.com. Join our discussion forums for some lively discussions about the American Civil War. And if you like, also visit our sister website, CivilWarWiki.net. Get more information about the Longstreet Monument and other monuments at the Gettysburg Battlefield.